It's about that time of day again. My name is Joseph. Monday evening, December the 11th. Welcome back to your nightly newsletter. We're covering crude oil, S&P, Nasdaq, gold, and euro this evening. Crude is bullish with a beautiful wedge pattern, right? Same thing we saw last week from oil. It's telling me to wait for traps down below prior swings with a measured move target waiting overhead on Tuesday. Speaking of Tuesday, S&P is bullish, but a recent blow-off candle, and we'll talk more about this as we go in tonight, a recent blow-off candle to finish today's session is telling me that either someone's been trying to short this market or the market has become quite irrational towards the end. Either way, I want to stay patient for a deep pullback down to major support, right, looking for the most reliable buying opportunities tomorrow. Nasdaq is also bullish. Nasdaq has its own blow-off candlestick to finish off today's session right up to the highs of a bull channel. This overshoot of a bull channel high tells me to expect an overshoot of that bull channel low. I'm looking for a two-legged pullback in the Nasdaq down in the battle zone tomorrow. And of course, how about some gold? The yellow metal continues to get beat up here this week, or this month, I should say. Gold is bearish again with two channels this time. We get a wide channel and a real narrow channel tonight on gold. One of those channels is telling me exactly where and where not to look for trades tomorrow morning. We'll grab a look at that in just a moment. How about the euro? Euro is bearish and trying to retest Friday's low. Yeah, bearish. We'll take a look at that a little bit closer here. Big strong dump off the high on the euro to finish off the session turns this market around. So now I've got to look for some levels of resistance overhead, and I have a really great trend line I'm watching for tomorrow's session. We're going to talk about blow-offs tonight. We're going to talk about overshoots and undershoots. Tonight we're going to talk about wedges and channels and trend reversals. We got a lot to cover here tonight. I got a great newsletter in store for you guys and gals this evening. Plenty of reliable setting opportunities or trading opportunities setting up for Tuesday's session. I want to remind you guys, if you're on my YouTube channel right now, to make sure you subscribe to the YouTube channel and make sure you adjust your settings to get notified every time I post a new video. And if you really want to stay in tune with what's going on, go into the description of that YouTube video and follow the link over here to sidewaysmarkets.com. This is our trading blog here at School of Trade. While you're here, don't forget, join the mailing list. I'll send you an email every evening when our nightly newsletter goes live and our psychology videos go live, right? So that's really the greatest way, the best way to really make sure you get everything that is School of Trade content. And then don't forget, while you're here, you might as well follow me on social media. I'm always posting exclusive content right on our social media channels, charts, links, and updates you're not going to see anywhere else. Speaking of charts, how about that? You can download all the charts from tonight's video. There's a link right there below the video on the blog here at Sideways Markets. Follow that link. That'll give you the chance to download the charts so you have them ready for tomorrow. And then speaking of tomorrow, what are you waiting for? Grab that free pass. Come out and join me as a guest in the trade room, right? If you're not a member here at School of Trade, right, wish you guys would grab that free pass and join me here this week in the trade room. And if you have any questions about membership, any questions about free trials, any questions about the free pass, whatever the questions might be, right? Whatever the question may be, hit me up on live support on the right-hand side of the website. All right, enough chit-chat here, JJ. You got a lot to cover here tonight. Big week ahead here. We've got quad witching this week. Yeah, I know, quad witching, which feels really early in the month of December. We got quad witching this Friday. Kind of give you a layout of what's happening here this week. Tomorrow is the beginning of the FOMC meeting, right? Don't those just sneak up on us, right, ever so often. That means tomorrow afternoon, 2 p.m. Eastern time, is going to be the announcement, right? So not tomorrow, but Wednesday afternoon, right? So Wednesday's the FOMC meeting announcement, not Tuesday. Tomorrow the meeting starts, right? Wednesday the meeting announcement. Thursday we have the ECB announcement, right? Always important for anyone trading in London session or gold or euro, right? And then don't adjust your television sets, kids. Friday is actually quadruple witching. Now, it feels like we just started the month of December, and we really did. But if you look at the schedule here, now, what is quad witching? Quad witching is every third Friday, right, of every 3 months. It's when all four asset classes expire. Okay, it's a big deal, and it has very much a self-fulfilling prophecy to it, in the sense that because people know it's quad witching, right, they avoid it, and because they avoid it, it makes price action more difficult, and because price action is more difficult, people avoid it, and of course the vicious cycle, right, continues. So the bottom line is, we have quite the busy week ahead of us. We get FOMC on Wednesday, Thursday's the ECB announcement, which may not affect us that badly here for the US session, and then we get Friday is quad witching, which just baffles me. But then we look at the calendar, the third Friday of the month, right? The first day of the month was a Friday. That's why it seems like this quad witching is just sneaking right up on us. And then, of course, you've got, right? Then, of course, you got one. That's 1 week, right? There's two, right? There's two Fridays. And, of course, the 15th, right, is the third Friday. So kind of a weird way this month has laid out. We don't see this very often. Usually quad witching is in that third full week. You know, usually it's a week from, right, this Friday. So it just kind of feels like that quad witching is sneaking right up on us. And it really is. It really is. Also kind of a bummer for anybody out there working a day job right now. A lot of the holidays are this year, you know, Hanukkah not so much, right? But Christmas and New Year's are right on the weekends, right? Don't you hate it when we waste a good holiday, right, on the weekend, right? I'm half joking, but what that means is that we're coming back right after New Year's, right? So at the end of the year this year, you know, at the end of December, we're coming right back January 2nd. So it's kind of a crammed in December, but don't blink, because we're coming right back. January 2nd is that Tuesday following the New Year. So I'll tell you, they're not going to give us much time off. They're not going to give us that much time off away from the markets this week or this month before we go right into, you know, usually we get like 2.5 weeks, you know, around the holiday season. This year it's like 10 days, right? Just because the first day of the month was a Friday and it's all getting kind of pushed in. All right. I could be talking Greek right now. I apologize for being a little bit chaotic here in my explanation there. But the bottom line, though, is if you're looking at the calendar this month and you're going, what in the who? How do we end up being quad witching this Friday? Quad witching is this Friday. So big numbers here. We get the meeting on Wednesday. That's pretty typical. Announcement Thursday, right? And then, of course, quad witching on Friday. That's not going to affect us too badly tomorrow. All this for nothing, Joe, but I want to make sure, as I always do on Monday's newsletter, right, can I give you an idea of what we're looking at, right, as we go. So tomorrow afternoon, we're going to worry about the FOMC, right? Wednesday afternoon, we'll start worrying about the ECB, right? The ECB, or Thursday afternoon, then we'll start worrying about, right, that Friday quad witching week, right? Quadruple witching. All right, now, as for the relatively actionable information tomorrow, what do we have here? Well, we don't have that much. We got a little bit here at 4:30 tomorrow morning, PPI and CPI from our good friends in Great Britain. And of course, right, we get the PPI number here in the US, right, tomorrow at 8:30 a.m. Eastern time, right? So those will be the big news events for tomorrow. We don't have a lot of distractions outside of the fact that I heard today, you probably haven't heard this, right? Bitcoin went on the futures. Oh, you have. I thought I was the only person who knew about that. I can't bump into a human being right now with them saying, did you hear about Bitcoin? Yes, we're aware about Bitcoin. And it may continue to be a little bit of a distraction tomorrow as well. And really right now, it is very much, I think distracting a lot of people right now from doing their jobs. My plan is to wait for early next year, once the CBOE, once the CME, and once the Nasdaq of all got it out of the way, right? Get everybody off of the races, and then we'll start hopefully seeing some decent price action that's tradable. Right now, there's no real trading on it, right? It's just buying and holding pretty much, right? But bottom line, though, is a lot of distractions today because of it, and I'd expect some more of that, right, to come in for tomorrow. Speaking of tomorrow, I've got a lot to cover here tonight. Now, you guys know kind of the plan or the calendar for the rest of the week. Get a wide open day tomorrow. We got crude, S&P, NASDAQ, gold, and euro to cover tonight, right? Starting off tonight, first of all, with crude oil. Crude is bullish with another beautiful spike and wedge pattern. And with the wedge getting a little bit too narrow right now, right, to trade within, my plan now is, rather than trading inside of this wedge, rather than trying to trade inside of this wedge, let's look for a deep pullback and let's look to buy that pullback tomorrow morning, or possibly right in the overnight Asian into London session. So, you know, I think there are a lot of important details here. The first one, of course, being strong spike up. We're making higher highs, and of course, whenever I see that strong spike up, I'm always inclined to look for a spike in channel. But you'll notice we're not getting rotation back down to the low of a channel. So we can call this a spike, that's for sure. It's definitely a spike. We're seeing new higher highs, but it really helps if you align those lows as well, and that creates a wedge. Now remember, most wedges are going to give you a target, but this target is way, way too far away for us to rely on right now. So I'm not going to use that as a target. I'm going to use these as a target. We get a measured move, right? That measured move going higher, right? Going higher here up at 58.20. But in all reality, if I had to guess right now, I would guess the big target for those buyers is going to be that prior week high up at 58.34. You know, those buyers are itching to get back to where they came from, right, early last week. So that's my targets for tomorrow. Where we'll be looking to get into trades here tomorrow. Well, one of the things I always talk about, and you may or may not have heard me say this before, is anytime I have overlapping candlesticks, right, like we did for quite a bit of time this morning, anytime we have overlapping candlesticks, what does that tell us? It tells us that a lot of volume likely traded hands in that area, right? Anytime we have overlapping candlesticks, okay? Overlapping candlesticks, the moving average will usually flatten out as well. Anytime we have overlapping candlesticks, right, we know a lot of volume, right? Price was acceptable there for buyers and sellers. And we also know that where there is a lot of volume, price oftentimes will pull back into that area where buyers have been comfortable trading before, right? And that's where we'll see those buyers coming in, right? If you're a volume profile theorist, right, you probably know the words to this song. Or if you've studied the auction market theory in my beginner's classes, right, you probably know, right, what I'm talking about as well. If this is the first time that you've heard about this, just rest assured, anytime you see a short-term trading range, that short-term trading range, double tops, double bottoms, flattening moving average, that can always be used as a level of support in this case, right, in a bull market. So the bottom line really right now is I know where I want to get in. I know where I want to get out. Now it's just a matter of, right, where's going to be the entry trigger. Most important thing on a wedge is to look left, find some of these prior swings. You know, when the wedge was really wide earlier on in the process, I can trade inside of that wedge, no sweat. But now that I've got the wedge getting a little tiny here, right, relatively narrow here, I got to start thinking about buyers growing weary of buying the low when there isn't a lot of profit to make back to the high and looking for, right, a pullback. How about a pullback like this, right? This might be something we get tomorrow. A little trap low below the 72 into a seller failure. Those sellers fail on strength, right, and we buy the pullback back up to retest the high. Trap low, seller failure, pullback for the buyers, right? Now, this obviously could be a little bit lower here. Maybe it's a deeper pullback. Maybe we see one of my favorite patterns, a two-legged pullback, up, down. Now we get into that battle zone. Moving average comes over, right? We look for the bears, try to sell that pullback. If they fail, we can buy into their failure, strength, pullback, and go from there, right? Same sequence, just a little bit deeper, right? Use a resistance trend line coming down off the high, which we're going to see an example of that in the euro later on. And then, of course, we have the seller failure, and then, of course, buyer pullback going back up. Don't forget, the objective will always be to retest the high, right? So be careful about chasing that move, right, going back up to retest the high. That's if price goes lower. What if price goes sideways here? If we start going sideways, right, keep an eye out for another trading range. Remember, anytime we see a trading range, we know a lot of volume, right, changed hands, buyers and sellers exchanging, right, trades back and forth. That's what creates a trading range. And with a trading range, right, going sideways, we want to look for that one try, two try, and back up, right, right back up into that range we go. What if price goes higher? You know, we covered down, we covered sideways. What if price goes higher here? If price goes higher, we get a measured move waiting overhead. One of the beautiful things about a measured move is they usually result in a two-legged pullback and a retest of the high. That will be my goal tomorrow if the market keeps going higher without pulling back, right? I've done many videos on this topic on this nightly newsletter talking about the four phases of a trend. If you want some homework out there, guys and gals, check out my blog at sidewaysmarkets.com, right? And use the search box and search for the four phases, right, of a trend. And you'll find the tutorial, right, on the four phases. Right now, we are in phase number one, right? We're waiting for phase number two, right, to attract buyers. And phase three is to rotate back to those highs, right? If we're in phase one and we just keep going higher, we're still waiting for that pullback, right, to buy from there. So wait for that pullback, even if the market goes higher here in the short term. How about a reversal, right? How do we reverse tomorrow? We always look for three things. One, strong move down. Two, test of the moving average. Three, strong move through, right? One, strong move down. Two, test of the moving average. Three, strong move through. Once I see that strong move through, then I know this isn't just a failure going back up to retest the high. Once I see that strong move through, then let's draw that channel down, bada bing, bada boom, right? Find that level of resistance, and we'll grab that sell back down, hopefully back down from there. Where's their objective at that point? The objective is to get back down to retest that low. We get something similar to this setting up on the euro right now. So stay tuned, right, for the end of the newsletter, right, on that euro. All right, so crude's looking great here. Looking good. All we need now is a pullback here on crude. Let's keep going here. Let's keep going. Now, the topic of this video newsletter tonight was the blow-off strategy, right? And we've got a couple blow-offs we're going to cover here right now. We got S&P, then we'll go Nasdaq, and then, of course, a little bit of a blow-off on the gold tonight. Starting off with the S&P, though. S&P is bullish, obviously bullish, with a multi-day, right, bullish channel. Now, this blow-off candle or climax candle to finish today's session, it tells me that I should expect a rather sharp correction lower or a possible trading range going sideways tomorrow. You know, the bottom line is I don't feel like buying the high of this two-day spike in channel, especially with that overshoot at the high. So I'm going to wait for a more reliable buying opportunity down at those lows and hopefully in that battle zone tomorrow. Couple actionable things here right now. First of all, we can see here on the Emini. Don't forget we're on the 318 contract this week after rollover last week. This is a pretty well-behaved spike in channel. Now, what's the first thing that stands out when you see that spike in channel? There's no traps. We haven't seen a single pullback go below a prior swing. None, right? So right away, this is already telling you anyone who is waiting to buy low, really low, has barely had any opportunities. Okay, it also tells me to do it this way, for a market to act like this, right, almost everybody has to be in long. And what do you think? If everybody's buying, there won't be that many buyers left to buy up here, and something has to give. Okay, all it takes is some economic news tomorrow, people take profit, right? All it takes is people to stop buying at this high, and we get a pretty sharp pullback. So just that alone, right? Just that alone, the fact that we haven't seen any real deep pullbacks, there's been no two-legged pullbacks here, really ever since Friday, right? That was the last two-legged pullback, right? We got one little guy right there, right? But again, they're not going below any of these prior, right? None of them, right, have really had any traps. So anyone who's conservative is still waiting on the sidelines, and they're going to be waiting patiently when it does come pulling back down. Another actionable piece of information, we have one leg. Mm-hmm. We have two legs. Yep. We have three legs. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, we got four legs. Now, we talked about this last week, right? What did we talk about last week? Three legs. We said that usually if a trade goes three legs higher, it'll usually be pulling back. Why? Because as we talked about last week, right, it was the market makers, then it was the institutions, right, and then, of course, picking up the rear, right, we have the general public, right, the general public who are getting in on this. So we talked about kind of the psychology of these three-legged moves, and I also talked about how difficult it was for, in most situations, now, you know, we'll see what we get tomorrow, but in most situations, when we go, we try to go four legs, right, four legs higher, four legs are usually just about as far as a market goes before we see a real sharp correction. Okay, now obviously tomorrow's a new day. I can't tell you what's going to happen tomorrow, but all I know is we're four legs up right now. And when you combine that, well, three and a half legs, let's say that, right? When you combine that with the fact that we haven't seen any traps, right? No real deep two-legged pullbacks to allow buyers to buy really anything more, right, than a 10% pullback. Now we're starting to see the only traders up here, right, are either completely irrational buyers or, right, or possibly sellers who've been trying to fade this market and they keep getting stopped out, right? I'm getting ahead of myself. Now, next thing, prior week high. We're right back knocking on the door of that prior week high. What I can see here is we haven't actually tested that prior week high. So that's a big, big target. We may end up kind of hitting that high in the overnight session and then start getting that pullback. Remember, though, anytime we reach a major milestone, like a measured move, right, or a weekly high, something like that, we usually pull back, two-legged pullback, and do it again anyways. Final clue. Then we'll go into the plan for tomorrow. Final clue is, right, we have this, again, what I'm calling a blow-off candle. You may call this a parabolic move. You may call this a climax candle or a climactic move. The bottom line is, right, when I was a new trader, I would look at a chart like this and go, who is buying up here, right? I mean, green candles, how do we get green candles? Green candles are either buyers buying or sellers becoming buying. So think about this for a second. Who on earth, at the end of the day today, right, is a buyer on this market? I'll tell you, nobody who knows what they're doing, right? The dumb money, right? Like I said, we're almost four legs up, okay? And then to go over the top of this, right, of this channel, right? Well, we'll see how dumb the money is tomorrow if we're up at 2,700 tomorrow, right? Feel free to comment me on that. But the bottom line, though, is, historically speaking, we're three and a half legs higher. We're overshooting the high. Who the hell is buying up here? It's probably not a buyer. What probably it is it's probably sellers who have been going, we've gone too far, this can't keep going higher forever, right? And they're scaling into this as it's going higher. And towards the end of the session, they're thinking, maybe I was wrong. And now's their time. They've got to get out, right? Basically take their lump and go home. So that's probably what's happening here. The bottom line is, whether it's foolish, and again, we'll see how foolish it is, depending on what happens tomorrow morning, right? If it keeps going higher. But typically speaking, foolish buyers, right, buying high, or what my gut tells me is somebody tried to get too aggressive to the sell side, right, and they're getting out at the very end, take their lump and go home. What it really means is it means that there's probably not a lot of real demand up here, okay? It's sellers getting out, kind of artificial demand. Right, it's irrational rookie, you know, general public, you know, cell phone trading, you know, buyers, right? They couldn't get their Bitcoin shares today, right? Or contracts today, so they tried to, you know, decided to buy the high of the S&P, things like that. Uneducated traders. I don't think there's going to be, in most situations, a lot of demand up here. What happens a lot of times is with this kind of elevated, inflated price because of short covering, right, and because of the rookie buyers chasing the move higher, normally there's nobody here to buy the pullback and the price will pull back relatively sharply. So I've gone through a lot of information here, right, between the one, two, three, three and a half legs higher, between the lack of any real pullbacks here, right, and that blow off, I'm really looking for a nice deep pullback here to be a buyer tomorrow. Okay, now, unlike on crude oil where we had a trading range on crude, we don't see any overlapping candlesticks, right, unless you go all the way back and look at this area right here. So really the point I'm making is that it's possible that we get a big, big pullback, but if that happens, this market turns bearish by the time we pull all the way back. So don't hold your breath for a pullback there to be a buyer. By the time we pull back all the way there, this will be a bear market at that point, right? Won't be a bull market if we wait for the turn. So my plan here, much like I talk about in crude oil, would be, you know, really if price goes down, sideways, price goes up. So what if price goes down? Price goes down, trap low, failure, right, breakout and pullback. Very similar pattern, right, that we talked about on oil, right? Trap low, failure, and then buying that pullback. That's relatively easy if price, right, if price pulls back lower. Maybe we get really lucky. Maybe we get a nice deep pullback here, right? Two-legged pullback, trap low, failure, breakout, pullback, go higher, right? Trap low, failure, breakout, pullback, go higher, right? Price pulls back. That's pretty easy. What if price goes sideways? Now, see, if nobody takes their profit here, you know, and this could easily happen. If nobody takes profit, right, but nobody wants to buy up here because people understand how lofty this is, price could start going sideways tomorrow. If price starts going sideways, then we know we have to be careful, and I'm looking for that trap low, right, and back up from there, right? We've talked about that a few times on oil. And then what if price goes higher? I wouldn't be surprised. You know, we just barely missed that prior week high by literally a tick, right? So I wouldn't be surprised if it goes higher here. I'm still waiting for that pullback here for tomorrow. How do we turn bearish? Strong move down, hold that, right? Hold that pullback, right? And follow through, right? Got to get that follow through for this to be a bear market. That's why I said earlier, if we end up back down to that 2648 area, 2647 area, it's going to be a bear market by the time that happens, right? So we'll look for that move up, right? And look to sell back down from there. I would imagine the short-term objective for the bears be back into that trading range. And then from there, they're going to try to get back down right to that low from Thursday's rollover, then at 26.29. But don't hold your breath on that, right? Because as of right now, we can see the demand in the market coming in right now. Yeah, anyone who bought that high is saying, we'll see who the dummy is tomorrow, JJ, right? Please don't take that. Personally, I meant obviously, historically speaking. All right, now on to the Nasdaq here. Nasdaq is pretty similar, right? Nasdaq's pretty similar here right now. Nasdaq is bullish with another blow off, right, to the high of this channel, telling me this market is either transitioning into a much steeper channel or possibly a spike in channel. But if not, right, we'll likely see rotation back down to the low of the channel where I will be looking for buying opportunities off the low. Now, a little bit different here on this one, right? We didn't really see much of a measured move here, but we definitely can see that double up level holding as an area of resistance. So targets for the buyers are up here prior month high, triple up target, right up there at 42.75 for tomorrow. And then the most important thing right now is this channel, right? Channel fits really nicely. And of course, we have a double overshoot of that channel. That double overshoot, anytime we have a double overshoot, that tells me one of two things. Either we're creating a new channel, such as this one, or, right, that double overshoot will result in a pretty steep two-legged pullback, right, possibly down into major support levels here for tomorrow. So double overshoot, very important clue here, tells me that either we are looking for a new channel, okay, which I have illustrated here for you guys, come off that low, up that high, right? Or that's just simply a double overshoot and we're going to come crashing back down, right, for that move. Combine that with this, again, what appears to be a completely irrational price action here to finish up the session. Is it short covering rally or is it, you know, again, don't, you know, pardon the term, or is it, you know, dumb money chasing after the market going higher? Historically speaking, there probably isn't going to be a lot of demand up here, right? Again, we might be seeing kind of a transformation here into a new bull channel. So usually when we see a market blow off, right, towards the end of the session, it's usually because short sellers who are trying to short the top of, right, of this market under the guise of it can't keep going any higher, right, they have to kind of pay the piper and they've got to get out, right, and they become buyers. So what's my plan here for tomorrow? Well, first of all, I'd love to get this price back down, right, to the low of that channel. Look out for a two-legged pullback to do that. Could be relatively sharp tomorrow. Two-legged pullback, do that down in the battle zone. I'm also watching for this untested, what I call a naked reversal line. They're at 86.75. That would be a little bit more drama on the way coming down, but it would give you another chance here, right, to be a buyer. Trap low, failure, right, and then break out, we go from there. Trap low, failure, right, and then break out from there. That's if price goes lower. What if price goes sideways here? You can almost kind of see it forming here as we go, right? As price goes sideways, if we don't keep making new higher highs, right? We're not reversing, but we don't keep making new higher highs. We'll call it a trading range. One try, two try, and buy up from there. That's relatively easy. Okay, what if I'm the fool? What if I'm the dumb money for tomorrow? I'm kidding with you, right? But what if, you know, again, what if price keeps going higher? You know, every day is a new day. What I'm going to look for is that rotation and try to use this channel together, right, with the others, right? So let's kind of see how that works there, right? We'll try to use that, right, as we go higher tomorrow. The key is going to be, though, I don't want to see some wimpy move higher. I want to see it really show me proof. I want to really see some proof here on that mark going higher so I can draw that trend line correctly, right, and buy off of that low. How to return bearish? Strength, pullback, strength. Strength, pullback, strength. I'm watching the low of this channel, right? We'll watch the low of that channel, and hopefully that channel will hold for the bears. We'll get that now as a new bear channel, mark up those resistance levels, and then again, look for that sell up at resistance, right? Remember, one of the most difficult parts of a trend reversal is not chasing after the market as it dumps, right? Because it's very difficult to really kind of time that, you know? Sometimes when a market reverses, we'll see on Euro here in a second, sometimes when the market reverses, though, right, it just kind of tiptoes its way down and then comes back up. Sometimes, though, it just dumps. It's very difficult to really tell how far it will go. So I always wait for that two-legged pullback after a trend reversal and then try to sell it from there. Good example of a blowover. One more blowover. Okay, let's do it. How about some gold? Gold, the yellow metal, is bearish with two channels. One is very wide and the other is very narrow, right? I feel like... Well, what was it? The three bears? One bed's too soft. One bed's too Red Riding Hood, was it? Damn, I'm good at my old age. Right? Anyways, you get the old fairy tale. Was it a fairy tale? It was a fairy tale, wasn't it? One bed's too soft. One bed's too hard. One bed is just right. Anyways, we got two channels here right now. How do I remember these things sometimes? Wide channels. We got a wide channel and a narrow channel. Wide channels are unreliable because the momentum of the market is so strong as we finish the move back down to those lows that it's unlikely we rotate all the way back up to the high. So what I'll do is, and this is a great trick, anytime the channel is really wide like this, add the 50% midline. And that 50% midline will usually come in and act as a level of resistance. It's kind of like we kind of split the channel into two halves, right? And then kind of use the underside, right, of that midline. Now you'll notice, right, we also have another channel, right, that narrow channel. Now these narrower channels, these are much, much more reliable. You don't need to add a midline here because the midline, I always tell my clients, add a midline to a narrow channel if you need a little bit more confirmation that you have the right channel. Okay, you'll notice when I add that midline on, you can see everyone's using it, right? However, are you really going to have enough room inside of that channel to really use the midline? Probably not, right? Probably not. So if you want to make sure, you know, is this the right channel? Usually the midline will tell you the proof of that, right? But the midline's not going to be as useful, right, on this bear channel. Now, anytime we have a nice steep bear channel, we always know we're looking for that two-legged pullback and then a retest, right, of that low. And it'll usually happen right around that moving average. Okay, so moving average, big, big area of resistance. And then obviously we have, right, kind of some naked reversal lines that would be great to use there, right? That's the battle zone, right, as well. So the plan really for tomorrow is get it up so we can sell it back down. That's pretty much it. So let's do the plan for up, down, and sideways. There's really no measured move here, you know, but definitely you can see that blow off, right? Who's selling down here at the end of the day? Right? Good question, right? In this case, it's probably buyers who are trying to reverse this trend. You know, buyers who probably said, it can't keep going lower forever, right? This big move down, right, last week. I'll tell you, that's what I used to think when I was a new trader. And what's the old saying? The market can be irrational longer than you can be, right, than you can be solvent. You know, a good example of that, anybody trying to fade Bitcoin right now, right? That market will tear your head off trying to sell it. And the hard part is you won't be able to find anybody to take the opposite side of that trade back at those highs. So the bottom line is I assume that this blow off is just buyers who foolishly tried to call a reverse, didn't wait for the trend. And they were holding it, holding it, holding it, holding it. And they said, okay, I guess I got to pay the piper now. They become sellers, right? Because buyers, when they cover their positions, right, when buyers get out, they become sellers. They're going to sell their way out, right? So that's what kind of leads to that blow off. This one's a lot easier to see. But again, I don't think you're going to see any demand down here, right? There's no demand for contracts to sell down here. It's just buyers that got out. That's why they usually produce those sharp corrections back in the opposite side, right? Sharp move down oftentimes leads to a sharp move right back up again, much like we saw sharp move down, sharp move back, right back up again, right? So it's amazing how price action has kind of a mirror impact, right? The strength of it going up is usually the strength of it going right back down, right? And it can get pretty ugly. So price goes up. We can already kind of see this trend line showing up right now. Two-legged pullback going higher overhead, or maybe we get something similar, right? Or something simple. Strong move up, buyers sort of buy the pullback, right? And we fail. Really, the main objective is get back to the moving average. Personally, I'd like to get above the moving average just because then you get some buyers trying to reverse the trend and we can sell that reversal. Okay, now, as I mentioned earlier, with this wide, wide bear channel, I don't expect the market to be able to get all the way back to the high and then go back down. Just be aware, though, if we did happen to reverse trend here, right, be very careful, though, buying into that high, because you're probably going to see bears coming back in and try to run this market back down. A lesson I learned many, many years ago was that when the channel's really wide and flat like this, it's probably going to go about halfway and then right back down again, right? Those wide channels. That's why I say wide channels really aren't that reliable. What if price goes sideways here? Now, price could go sideways in a trading range, bear bias, up one try, two try, and back down, right? Again, same things, just opposite direction, right? Or it could go lower. If it goes lower, it may also kind of look like a trading range, right? But almost have kind of a channel, you know, spike in channel or a spike in wedge kind of feeling to it. If that's the case, keep an eye on those first few swings. Wait for that jump up, right? And sell that sucker back down with traps, right? So price goes up, looking for buyer failures. Price goes sideways, look for a trading range and a failed breakout going higher. If price goes lower, it'll probably end up grinding lower just because of the big blow off at the end of the day's session. And if that's the case, we're still looking for that chance to sell high. How do we turn bullish? Strength, pullback, strength, right? Strength, pullback, and then strength. The only problem is you've got that trend line overhead here. So be careful. What you want to do in that situation is anytime we find ourselves in a position where we're bullish, but we're buying into resistance, what do? We look for traps, right? Traps and buy from there. Okay, so we'll look for that trap, right, and buy from there. Think about these wide channels, right? There's so much momentum that gets built, right? Momentum really picks up speed as it goes lower, right? It's going to take a small miracle. It can happen, but it's not likely to go all the way back up and then have bears come in, right? It's probably going to go up and then come right back down, right? By the time we go back up to the opposite side, the momentum is so strong going higher that it's difficult. It's not just going to sink back down again, right? It'll take some time to make that turn and go back down to retest that low. Again, because of the momentum of that market. Now, speaking of momentum, here we have, this could get a little bit ugly tomorrow. How about some euro to wrap things up here tonight? Euro is bearish after collapsing off today's high. So my plan is to look for selling opportunities using the falling resistance trend line up above that moving average for a target going back down to retest Friday's low. Well, here's an example. Strong move down, hold the pullback and go. Yep, giddy up to the downside, right? The sheer strength of this move going lower just tells me do not try to be a buyer on this out the gate, right? The sheer strength of this. Well, you tell me. Anytime we see a strong move in one direction, I'm giving it to you. I'm giving you the answer on this on a silver platter, right? Anytime we see a strong move in one direction, what do we usually see? We see a two-legged pullback and a retest of the high. I'm not making this stuff up, guys, right? I may not look that smart, right? I'm not that smart either. I've been looking at charts for a long time, right? And over my career, right, you pick up on these things. Anytime you see it strong with one direction, we typically get a two-legged pullback and a retest the high. Okay, so now think about it. Strong move in one direction. What do you think I'm looking for? Yeah, two-legged pullback, retest the low, right? Retest the low. Okay, so that's kind of my plan short term, right? And then, of course, long term back down to retest that low. Now, you might be shaking your head right now going, oh, man, this guy's done too many newsletters. He's officially done gone crazy, right? Because look at this. This is bullish, right? This is a bullish trend. Why aren't we looking for this to go up to retest the high? Well, a couple of reasons why. First of all, we have that strength, pullback strength. That does not look like happy campers to the buy side, right? It doesn't. If the buyers were aggressive, right, the buyers were here, they would have bought that failure going right back up. Or, right, you wouldn't have seen that big red candle below that low, right? That red candle would look like this, right? If it had a big wick at the bottom, I'd be whistling a different tune right now, right? So I'm not going to say that I haven't gone crazy, but I'm going to say right now, though, the buyers have to show me some real good proof here for me to trust them going back to retest the high. But you're absolutely right, right? We had a bull channel, right? Nice strong move back to the high, but look what happened. It doesn't look like those buyers wanted much more, right, than to get back to that high. They gave up on it and dumped it. So now I get that falling resistance trend line overhead. Don't get me wrong, the buyers could easily go up, hold, and go, right? But again, that's going to take a small miracle at that point, right, for those buyers to hold that pullback there, right? Because it'll probably collapse and just run. So my plan for tomorrow, I'm kind of using this right there. We don't have a lot to work with. The moving average really is my main goal here right now. I want to get up, failure, and back down. Or maybe a two-legged pullback of our own, right? And we go up, two-legged pullback of our own here in the overnight session. The bottom line is I do have the edge right now to the bears. The bears are looking for sell back down and then, of course, get that target all the way back down to retest low. Price goes up, looking for buyer failure into pullback and move back lower. Price goes sideways. I almost hope it goes sideways just to really solidify this. If price goes sideways, look for a trading range. One try, two try, sell above the high in a bear market, trading range with the high. What if price keeps going lower? If price keeps going lower, this will act like a channel, right? So if we do just get the price to rotate lower, up and back down we go. Not much changes if it goes lower. We're still waiting for, right, that chance to sell high. How do we turn bullish? How do we turn bullish? Well, a little bit too cuckoo, right, to the downside here, right? So I don't want to be a buyer yet, but if we can hold above that trend line and really run, then we can at least give this back to the buyers. It'll be a trading range, and we'll be back to retest that high, but at least then I'll know I can buy either here or here, right? Either I'm going to buy the pullback there, or we're going to buy, right, the failure back there. The bottom line is if we see a run back up, that gives the buyers new life. I'm not planning on it, but at the same time, I don't make the rules. I just trade what I see. And right now I see a real sharp pullback. It's probably a little bit too sharp to get buyers on board, especially with that falling resistance. So I'm looking for a sell going back down to retest that low. Boy, that time flies by when you're having fun. I love the action we've had so far this week. Got another big day here for tomorrow. Don't forget Wednesday FOMC. Thursday we hear from Draghi at the ECB. And Friday is that weird, right, quad witching Friday. So get at it early here this week. And don't forget, if you haven't done so yet already, make sure you join our free trial on the homepage here at School of Trade. If you're on YouTube, there are links on the YouTube description below the video. While you're here, don't forget beginner, intermediate, advanced classes, and I'm always here to answer your questions 24/7. Thanks for putting up with my stupid jokes here tonight, guys. Always like to have some fun with you guys and gals. Don't forget, tomorrow morning, 8 o'clock Eastern time in the trade room. If not, I'll see you guys same time, same place tomorrow afternoon. Adios, amigos. Bye-bye for now.